Hey everyone, Tin Man here, back with another episode of Precise Plays, the series where I review my own gameplay footage from dungeons and raids, look for opportunities for improvement, identify mistakes, and just generally explore my strategy to see what I can improve on. Now here we've got a Mythic Plus 7 Theater of Pain, and I'm playing my Frost Mage in the second day of Mythic Plus being released here in Shadowlands, so it's still some challenging content, and we're still a little bit under-geared for what we're up against. There's three affixes this week. We've got Fortified, so the trash packs are pretty strong. We've got Bursting, which honestly in this season hasn't been that strong. Whenever you kill the mobs, you get a little dot applied to you, but really it doesn't hit all that hard. And Volcanic, so you just need to be able to stutter step out of the volcanoes that spawn under your feet. Here on this first two packs, we don't pop any of our cooldowns, or at least I don't. I don't use Icy Veins or Rune of Power or anything because we have a boss fight right after these trash packs, and so we want to have all of those up for the boss fight just to burst down that boss as quickly as possible. And these pulls aren't too terribly challenging if you pull them separately. If you did pull this Raging Bloodhoof along with the Raging Bloodhorn with the first three, it could be a little bit dicey, but that's not the case here. We pull them separately so that we can preserve our cooldowns, and even if we are taking this a little bit slow, we'll be nice and strong, ready to burst down this boss fight as quickly as possible. Now, for this next boss fight, I'm going to slow it down to about half speed, just because there's several things I want to mention, and it does happen pretty quickly. So right on the pull here, we do pop Time Warp, I pop Icy Veins, my Trinket, and everything else on Sethel, who's going to be our primary target in this boss fight that we want to kill off first. Unfortunately, I hit him so hard with crits and everything that I do pull aggro off our tank. He doesn't hit me very hard, he doesn't even auto-attack me at all, but it does cause a little bit of a disruption because the tank has to come and pick him back up, and moves them out of a blizzard and our flame patches, so we do lose some damage on the bosses here. Now, I don't cast my Rune of Power right after the first one expires from the Icy Veins, and that's going to be a big problem. I'm losing damage by not having that Rune of Power down. And it actually does come back to bite me here in just a moment. I do get targeted with the Opportunity Strike, but I'm able to Ice Block that off and cancel the Ice Block right away so I can get right back to DPSing. But I still haven't used that Rune of Power here, and after dodging out these Volcanics, I do finally put it down. But the problem is, it's right as I'm getting fixated, and I should have, well, first off, I should have just cast Rune of Power earlier, and I would have got full value out of it, but I should have at least canceled it once I realized I was getting fixated, but I didn't have quick enough reaction there, and I end up just losing so much value. That Rune of Power is just on the opposite side of the arena as I have to kite around to get rid of this fixate, and so I lose a lot of damage by not efficiently using that Rune of Power. So I might look into finding a good UI element or something to alert me that, hey, cast the Rune of Power after that first one expires. Now, even after that fixate's done, I do make a little bit of a mistake with my target selection here. I did spend a lot of time targeting the higher health enemy, the one who's fixated on me, as opposed to the lower health ones. And in this boss fight, you can just kill off the lower health ones and remove their mechanic from the fight and be just fine. So you really want to be focusing down the lowest health target, but I don't do that as much. My target selection is poor here. Ideally, if they're nice and close, I can cleave off both of them, and that's what ended up happening in the end, but I still could have maybe contributed a bit more damage to the lower health targets and made the fight just a touch easier throughout. Maybe not something that's going to wipe us here early on, but if we get up to higher keys, then it might end up being a problem. Skipping ahead here a little bit to the next trash pack, I do make a little mistake as I pop Icy Veins right as we pull this, but it does drop Rune Power right as you activate it, and I dropped that at the top of the stairs as I kept on running down the stairs just to make sure I was in range, and so I actually have to work my way back up to my Rune Power to make sure that I am back in range and gaining that bonus damage. Luckily though, most of this trash in this wing is pretty easy to deal with as a mage. Their mechanics are just not terribly difficult for me. You know, there's this big ground targeted AoE that you can just very easily blink out of, and all in all, it's a pretty straightforward wing to deal with. So we're going to speed up this clip here a little bit just to get to a more interesting part. So as we finish up this little mini boss, there are several more of mini bosses that have basically identical abilities to him throughout this hallway, this wing here. We do try to sneak past this one, don't manage to get past it, we do have to pull it, and I do manage to get clipped by her jump ability. I thought I was just out of range of it, but apparently did get hit, and I have to blink back to the center here to avoid pulling the pathing pack on the bridge there. So I do drop a little bit low and have to walk out of this next one as I wasted all my blink charges, but still, even with all that, this is a pretty trivial mini boss, I guess. You just DPS it down, dodge the swirlies, and interrupt her whenever possible. The next pack on the bridge, though, this one is a bit more challenging as we wait for it to path back here and wait for our healer to drink and our tank to be ready. This next pack here is kind of rough. You do want to be focusing down the captain here that we have marked with Skull and interrupting his debilitating shoutcast, because if that does go off, then your entire team loses a bunch of damage output for the duration, while you just cleave down the conscripts on the side. So that's what we're doing here. We get the captain down relatively quickly, but there's a lot of damage going out to the group here, both from the bursting as well as the shots and their other abilities from these conscripts. And I do get a big shield here, both powered shield and my ice barrier, since I do drop pretty low, but not a lot of direct, like, actual healing coming out on me. And I sit at this low health for quite a while, and I probably should have just used my health potion, or I didn't have my health stone available, or I should have just ice blocked, but I didn't realize that I was going to be taking damage from this Jagged Quarrel ability. There was, like, no indication that I was about to take that hit, and I just frankly didn't expect it, and I should have, you know, I'll know that for next time, that I should use a defensive or a health potion or health stone if I'm getting low here, because the healer is definitely struggling to keep everybody up, because everybody was taking quite a bit of damage at that point. So going on to this next little mini boss here, we're actually going to skip it by using Blinks and Stampeding Roar and other abilities to kind of get past it before it becomes targetable, because we don't think we need that for percent. We don't know the exact optimal route, that'll still come over time, but we didn't think we needed it, but we do end up a little bit short on trash at the end, so we'll have to make an extra pull later to make up for that. So maybe we should have pulled that. Anyway, on this boss, he's a pretty straightforward one. It's just a single target boss that occasionally pops up a secondary banner that you have to cleave down, which is great for Frost. They love two target cleave. And then his abilities are fairly easy to dodge out of using Blink ability. He does like a three ability combo to that you can just blink out of, like this big frontal cleave, you blink away a big circle around him, and he also does like a frontal cone. Now at some point we do lose our warlock here. It does end up getting hit. Warlock obviously does not have quite as much mobility as compared to mage, we do have to get battle res out on him. Luckily we have our tank to do that, and then both me and our fire mage get thrown down into the arena, and we have to like PvP duel. And since our Fire Mage didn't have any of his cooldowns up or unavailable, and I did have Icy Veins, we decided that he would just let me win this fight. Unfortunately, sometimes it's a little bit slow as a Frost Mage to win this fight, because you're just spamming Frost Bolts hoping for procs if you're not using the cooldowns. But once we get back up here, I pop the Icy Veins and drop the Rune of Power, and I walk my way back to it once I have to move out, thanks to his combo ability. But then after that, this boss is pretty easy. You just, you know, make sure you kill the banner so that everyone can move freely, and there's nothing to it. I do end up getting thrown down into the pit one more time for the PvP, but he is so low at the end of that that it doesn't really matter, since we just kill him very quickly thereafter anyway. So next up, we tackle the Altars of Agony wing here, and this little gauntlet running up to the platforms is a real struggle, actually. There's these mobs that will channel this rooting, almost a root effect on players, while there's these green swirlies that you have to dodge out, which is very hard if you are very much slowed by their abilities. And we actually end up fighting them here in this little corridor where the green swirlies spawn, and that's a mistake. We definitely want to be pulling them back into one of the hallways. We figure that out after this first initial pull, but it goes quite poorly as our warlock dies very quickly to probably just being essentially rooted into one of these circles, as well as it's very frustrating for a fire mage, I know, who wants to be hard casting flame strikes, which are very long duration casts, so ends up having to ice block there. But we do eventually clean it up, only losing one here, although it was quite stressful. So we're discussing it, and we're like, okay, we're gonna pull this next pack back into the hallway so that we don't get these swirlies on top of us. So we're gonna hide back in this corner, rebuff up while our tank goes and pulls the next pack here. At this point, when I'm rebuffing for the warlock that died, I do realize that I did not have Arcane Intellect up from the last boss whenever I died on the bridge there. So always wanna make sure that you have whatever buffs like Arcane Intellect and Power Word Fortitude and whatever else up and available on you. In fact, noticing now, I don't have Fortitude up on me right here either. So unfortunately, I think our priest went a little bit forward to grip our tank back just to speed his running back here, because he was very much slowed by those mobs. But unfortunately, the priest dies to it. Luckily, the respawn is right in the chamber right behind us, so it's not a too far run. You can just release spirit and come right back into the fray. And they're bunched up. We put them in Blizzard, and it's no problem at all. So this was much easier to do it that way rather than fighting out here on the bridge, if possible. If it wasn't a fortified week, or if there wasn't like explosive on, or not explosive, if there wasn't bursting on the mobs, then maybe you could have run through and picked them all up at once and then just pulled them to this end corridor or this end tunnel. But we just decided to do it in two separate pulls just to be extra safe there. And even with that, we still ended up losing a few people. Now, in this next bunch of trash between here and the next boss, there's nothing too terribly interesting that happens. You just fight the mobs and go to, through the next portal. The one thing I will say is that when you do go through the portal, you do heal up to full HP, but you want to make sure the tank is going through first in case they will instantly aggro mobs right on the other side. But you don't need to worry about healing people up at the end of these trash pulls. You can just pull, or you can go through the portal as soon as you're done with it. That being said, we're just going to skip right ahead to the next boss because I don't think there is anything too terribly interesting to see in these little platforms here. As a DPS player on this next fight, there's basically just one mechanic that you need to worry about, and that is the draw soul debuff. So occasionally the boss will target two random players who will have their soul drawn out, and they'll be silenced and unable to attack until they go and reclaim that soul. So I get targeted with it here, and there's these little grasping hands circles around the edge of the room that you want to stand behind. So you want to have the grasping hands in between you and the boss. So our warlock here also had the debuff, but unfortunately he was positioned a little bit to the left of the circle. You want to be behind that so that when the soul gets drawn out, it gets caught in that grasping hands and you can just go walk forward to pick it up very easily rather than running all over the arena. So you can see both players here get targeted with the grasp soul. Neither of them is behind the circle. They're kind of to the left and right of it, and they're going to have to run after their souls, which are just kind of aimlessly wandering around the room here. Our druid gives them a stampeding roar to help them catch up just a little bit. But other than that, there's really not a lot going on in this fight. It's pretty much just a single target, just tank and spank here. For this next draw soul, there's no grasping hands just based on the overlap, or at least I didn't see it. Maybe there was one off to the right there, but I just decided to ice block it, which removes that and prevents that from happening, so I can just continue to keep on DPSing. Ice block is such an amazing utility to just be able to get out of a sticky situation like that and just completely nullify some mechanics here. So on this last one, I throw out a couple damaging spells, and while I'm horrified for a moment, the rest of our dots tick them down, and we get the boss dead pretty easily. I like this boss. That boss is probably the easiest boss, I think, out of all of Mythic Plus so far. Going into the final wing of the dungeon here, the disease wing, the most important thing to remember for this trash is to be stacked up as much as possible. Now there's these little jumping adds that are going to jump to random players at range. And so to optimize your AoE, you want to be nice and stacked up so that they still stay in your blizzard, your flame patches, or whatever other your AoE effects are whenever they're jumping around and hitting people. And it also makes healing more efficient for any kind of stacked up AoE healing. But you do want to make sure that you move out for things like Volcanic the Affix this week, as well as those little green circles that they drop whenever they die. But it's as long as you stay stacked up and maybe you control them with like an AoE stun, then they should die pretty quickly to any kind of AoE effects. And then there's these putrid belchers that don't really do too terribly much, so you definitely want to be focusing on the little jumping guys first here. They also have a cast ability, which you want to interrupt as much as you can. Our group does struggle a little bit with interrupts since we are three casters that have very long cooldowns on our interrupts. There's no melee here with like a shorter interrupt cooldown. So just interrupt wherever you can. It's always helpful. It also is helpful if you have a priest as your healer since they can cure diseases. Unlike, say, a shaman healer that can't get rid of a disease, priests can get rid of them. And so if some of those casts do go through, it's very helpful that your healer can just dispel them off here. Same thing with this pack here. There's also two of those leaping adds here. We don't do quite as good of a job in stacking up on this particular pull. You see they get pulled out of the blizzard, pulled out of some flame patches on the ground. But we do our best to stay as stacked up as we can. It's also a little bit hard here due to Volcanic. People want to be moving out of Volcanic, and since there's not a lot of room to move kind of left and right, or like move around in a circle around and still kind of keep the same stack point, you got to move forward or backwards on this narrow bridge. So that's part of what's causing this issue. And Volcanic is especially important whenever we're all casters and we don't want to get interrupted with that knock-up effect. But after all that, it's pretty easy to take them down. Moving to this next part, you can go either left or right. We choose to go right here. It's identical either way. It's really just the same mob on both sides, same kind of room. And this guy doesn't do much except for just constant ticking AoE damage, and he does a frontal and backwards cone. That's kind of unusual. Normally it's just a frontal cone out of units, but here he does a front and back cone. I make a similar mistake that I made earlier on the first boss fight by putting my Rune of Power down right as that ability is coming out, and I have to blink away from it, and then I quickly blink right back to it to get as much uptime out of the Rune of Power as possible. But you know, that's something that I could have just waited until after that first cast went off, and then I wouldn't have to move and still get maximum uptime on that Rune of Power. You can also kite around the central, it's not really a pillar, but you could, in some other places, this kind of central pillar would block line of sight. Here, it does not block line of sight. Going down here to this next trash pack, it's a little bit more of the same. You've got two tank mobs, and you've got two of the leaping mobs. Once again, you just want to be stacked up and so to control the leaping mobs a little bit. I don't stack up quite as well as I probably should. I stay in the back here a little bit since I want to get a pre-cast off, and I cast my Mirrors of Torment and Rune of Power. Once again, I do this a lot with my Rune of Power. I place it in inopportune spots because I should be stacked up closer to melee so that they're stacking up in my Frozen Orb and my Blizzard and in Fire Mage's Flame Patch. But I'm staying back here because I had already kind of committed to this Rune of Power in a suboptimal spot. I do blink forward once I kind of realize that, hey, I've got this aggro on this one and I want the tank to get it off of me. And so I kind of shade back to try to get value out of my Rune of Power as it's expiring. But it could have been avoided if I just delayed it and, you know, blinked into melee range right at start and then dropped the Rune of Power there rather than dropping it in the back to try to get one pre-cast off. That would have made this pull quite a bit cleaner, I think. Would have been a higher DPS for everybody involved and just would have gone better in general. This next pack on this bridge is a mess. So it looks like it's just one guy, one of those guys that does the frontal and back cone. But as soon as you walk forward, six of these jumping mobs spawn. So everything with the jumping mobs before, you get a stack up in melee, stack up in the AoE. But now there's six of them, and you've got to deal with this guy who's ticking AoE and doing the front and back cone. So and you're on a bridge, so it's very limiting. And so I blink away to try to dodge his cone, but that lets the jumpers get onto me. We're falling behind on heals just because there's a ton of damage going out here, and I actually end up going down, and so does our healer and our warlock too, all go down, and our other mage has the ice block. So we decide, okay, we can just release, and I'm thinking we're going to reset, but our tank's like, no, our tank is just a complete beast and is not going to die and is just going to kite them back to us. So we're trying to get back as quickly as possible. We buff up, use our blinks. I use the Venthyr Door of Shadows ability, which frankly, Door of Shadows looks like a great ability on paper to cover some distance, but it's in practice I haven't used it too terribly much, but here it helps a little bit to get back as a tiny bit quicker. Luckily though, our tank survives, we get everyone back healed up, and now it's just a simple matter of cleaning up these last mobs. I will say this is a pretty bad place to be tanking these guys. It's basically on two bridges. You have no like wide open space to try to dodge his frontal and back cones here. So I kind of position myself right behind him, and so he's going to target me with his next explosion here. And I position myself to try to blink down the hallway, and I click my blink ability, but I don't have any blink charges left, and I end up just walking right into the middle of it and taking both hits and dying very quickly. So should have maybe positioned myself better and not put myself in a position to need blink to get out of that, or maybe there was a safe spot kind of behind him towards that wall, but I was not able to get there in time. So I do end up dying there, and got to make the long run back to catch up with the team. This next boss, Gorchomp, is particularly easy if you are a mage, because blink basically trivializes the entire mechanic, or the main mechanic of the fight rather, the meat hooks that will sweep across the arena that you have to dodge. You normally would just have to do like a little dance to dodge in between them, or if you're a mage, you can just blink through them with ease. So he will pull people into melee here, and then you need to get back out to the safe spots in these chains, or in that case, I was a little bit slow, so I just blinked right out, and it was no problem at all. There are these leaping mobs that will still continuously spawn during this fight, and so you do want to be stacked up as much as you can so that they leap onto you and you can still cleave them down, but that is made problematic by his AoE and the fact that you've got to dodge these hooks. And so stacking up is not quite as important on this fight as making sure you never get hit by the hooks at all. And since we have such good classes for cleave here, our Frost Mage is great at 2 and 3 target cleave, so is Fire Mage, so is Affliction Warlock, we just decided we would focus the boss and just let our cleave take care of the little adds and not worry too terribly much about them. And we're also pretty mobile so that the patches on the ground, like we're not melee, we don't care about the fact that there may be patches around the boss, so that doesn't impact our DPS too terribly much. So just passive cleave and mainly focusing on the boss, and we get him down in relatively short order. Unfortunately, here at the end of the boss fight, we do realize that we are a few percentage short. Normally, we just go straight up to the final boss after this guy, but we're actually at 97% enemy forces, and that means we're going to have to pull one more mob. So remember back in the first wing, when those like mini bosses, that we decided to skip one because we thought we could get away with it and we didn't need it for percentage. Unfortunately, we did need that one for percentage. So we're looking at our map here. We're like, okay, where's a trash mob we can just pull for the 3% here? And we remember there's this gas bag over here on the left that we didn't pull that caused us quite a bit of trouble when we tanked it on this T-shaped bridge. So we learned from our mistake, and we would tank him in the room where he is supposed to be pulled at, and it's a lot easier to dodge his vile eruption frontal and back cone by just being much further away and having a little bit more space to work with. I stay out in the hallway, and we're able to clean him up for the last little bit of enemy forces percentage. Now we're on to the final boss fight of Theater of Pain here, and right before she becomes attackable, I pre-cast a blizzard just to get a little bit of damage on her while I can cast while she's not targetable. And our game plan for this boss is to save all of our cooldowns. You see I'm saving Icy Veins and Mirrors of Torment for whenever she goes down to 50% HP. That's when we're going to use Time Warp, and we're just going to blow her up as quickly as possible because things get very hectic at sub 50% there. Got to dodge out of that big frontal cone, and if it did happen to be turning towards me, it kind of turns in a random direction. I can just easily blink over it. For this mechanic here, where people get sucked in, you want to be loosely stacked up. You don't want to be overlapping your circles, but you will spawn an add, so you want to be as close to melee as possible just to maximize cleave damage. Here we get 4 of the 5 right in a blizzard range, so that's really great. And then we've got an AoE stun from our warlock to interrupt their casts. Here you do see a blink over that frontal cone whenever it does path towards you, or you can just run around it and trivialize that mechanic. So as we get close to here to 50%, I do use my second rune of power as it comes off cooldown, but it seems to be a recurring issue for me on this run is suboptimal rune of power usage. As you can see, I have to move away from this grasp, and then we do use the time warp as it is expiring. So I didn't get quite full value out of that rune of power. I could have potentially used it later, you know, here during the time warp. We do manage to kill her pretty darn quick though, so I'm not even positive that I would have gotten great usage out of it. Maybe just if I'd had some better RNG that I didn't have to run so far away from that black hole type effect, that would have been a better usage of the Rune of Power here. So I think my main takeaway from this dungeon here is twofold. One, with Rune of Power usage, obviously I mentioned that several times that I was suboptimally using Rune of Power, both in terms of timing and positioning with it. So that'll come partly with experience, and partly I might look into adjusting my UI to give me an audible notification whenever my Icy Veins Rune of Power runs out so that I can recast a new one. And the other thing I learned is just I need to be a little bit quicker about using my defensive abilities, like health stones and health potions in particular, whenever the healer is struggling, to make sure I can keep myself up and take pressure off the healers. Hope you enjoyed it, and thank you so much for watching, and I will see you next time.